This video covers the Bellman-Ford algorithm for finding single source shortest paths. After a quick review of the prerequisite knowledge, we'll see what the algorithm accomplishes, how and why it works, how quickly it works, few optimizations, and we'll finish with a worked example. This video absolutely does not stand on its own. You need the introduction from the playlist. That one has some prerequisites too, but trying to start this video without that one would be like starting in the middle of the video. Once you have that one, this video is quick and simple. Bellman-Ford can find the shortest distances and shortest path tree from any vertex to all other vertices in any directed or undirected weighted graph, although there are faster ways to go if the graph is undirected, so we'll assume that we have directed graphs here. It works even if the graph has negative weight edges and can also detect negative weight cycles, which are a bit of a problem for shortest weight paths. For this graph, with start as the start node, the negative weight edges don't cause any problems. We have well-defined shortest paths to A, B, and C. If we add a bit more to the graph, there is a negative weight cycle with three edges between D, E, and F, but it still doesn't cause any problems with this start node because it isn't reachable. But if I add more to the graph, we start to run into problems. Here we have a reachable negative weight cycle. What's the lowest cost path to get to H? It isn't 6 because I could go from start to G to H to G to H for cost 3. Or I could go around the cycle again for cost 0 or again for negative 3. I can make it as small as I want. Now, what weights mean depends on what problem you're working on. Maybe that cycle's good, maybe it's bad, but if there's a negative weight cycle, we want some way to mark it. We mark nodes on any reachable negative cycle as having weight negative infinity. If there's an edge from that cycle to C, that node is reachable through a negative weight cycle, its distance becomes negative infinity too. One last thing, if you use the path reconstruction algorithm for a negative infinity length shortest path, it doesn't work. It'll just take you backwards around that cycle over and over. G comes from H, comes from G. Don't try to reconstruct negative infinity weight paths. Now let's start the algorithm. At first, assume we don't have any negative weight cycles. We use the generic shortest paths algorithm from the introduction video. The only thing we need to do is specify an order to relax edges. I hope you really understood that introduction video because otherwise this won't make any freaking sense. This algorithm really relaxes all of the edges in an arbitrary order, but it does that V minus one times for V vertices. If there are no negative weight cycles, the shortest path tree will have no more than V vertices and V minus one edges. If we relax all of the edges once, we must have relaxed all of the edges on the top level of that tree, even if we don't know what the tree is. After that first level's finished, relaxing all of the edges a second time will relax edges from the first to the second level, finishing it. We don't know what the tree is, but with V minus one edges, it can't have more than V minus one levels. So after that many rounds, we hit every level. Extra relaxations happen, but as long as we have a critical edge ordering somewhere in the list, we're fine. That's great if we know there are no negative weight cycles. What if there can be? After finishing that first part of the algorithm, all vertices should have their final values. If there's a negative weight cycle, some vertex on it would continue to change its value if we kept going. So, run one more round through the edges. If anything changes, we found a reachable negative weight cycle. Maybe we just return false if there's a negative cycle or true if there isn't. If you want more, you want to find all vertices with normal shortest paths, but then specially mark all vertices reachable through a negative cycle, then we wouldn't just return false. Instead, use that detection round to change distance estimates to negative infinity, and then let the algorithm run more rounds to let those negative infinity values propagate through the graph. This pseudocode assumes that relax will understand that negative infinity plus a finite number is negative infinity. Each of those versions goes through all edges order v times, and they take order v times e time. But this code's really kind of dumb. Imagine in a graph with 1,001 vertices, that there's actually a shortest path tree that has only 10 levels of edges. After 10 rounds through the edges, you found the best paths. For sure, the 11th round of edge relaxations, maybe even early, but the 11th round won't change anything, nor will the 12th. But you keep going until you finish 1,000 rounds. If you relax all the edges for a round and nothing changes, you're done. You don't have to keep going, so check if that happens. We also add that shortcut to the negative cycle detection phase, which all gets skipped if the first part shortcuts. I highlight the important algorithmic changes, but not the fact that I changed a for loop into a while loop. The algorithm runtime now depends on two things. If there are reachable negative cycles, we're in the worst case and we'll go through all rounds of relaxation. If not, the number of rounds we need depends on how many levels there are in the shortest path tree with the fewest levels. Once we go through that many rounds, we'll have finished a critical edge ordering, and on the next round at the latest, we hit the shortcut. If you want to see why I use big O there versus theta for the negative cycles, stick around for the example at the end. I can think of one more shortcut you might or might not want to make. Every now and then, you might get a graph where only a small part of the graph is reachable from the start vertex. In that case, each time you go through all of the edges to relax them, you're relaxing some edges that aren't even reachable. You could pre-process the graph with breadth-first search on the start node, use that to make a list of reachable vertices and only relax edges out of those vertices. That's probably not going to help very often in general graphs, but when it does, it can save you a lot of time at the cost of that linear time pre-processing every time you run the algorithm. The analysis is similar to before, with time added for pre-processing. Okay, one example. On a simple graph with no negative weight cycles, this example shows how edge ordering can change the algorithm's runtime. For visibility, the shortest path tree is highlighted in blue. I assume the graph's adjacency list is in alphabetical order, with our start node conveniently named start, and we initialize. When we relax all the edges once, we start with a bunch of useless relaxations until we relax the start to E edge. That edge isn't on the tree, but it does successfully change a value. I'll color it red in the list. Next, relaxations from start to F and G successfully set correct shortest path distances. The shortest paths for those vertices have just one link, so they have to be correct after one round. In the next round, notice that the E to A edge successfully changes a value, propagating too large a shortest path estimate to A. That edge is on the final tree, but the distance isn't correct yet, because E's distance wasn't correct when the relaxation happened. So I'll color that purple in the list below. The F to E edge relaxes later, correcting E's distance and path. The next round, A gets fixed, and by now you should see that if the edges are ordered in an unlucky way, we get only one level of the shortest path tree fixed each pass through all of the edges. We've done three rounds, and only vertices with shortest paths of three or fewer lengths have the correct distances. In the fourth round, our luck turns, and the edges for the rest of the tree are relaxed in an order that lets edges on successive levels of the shortest path tree take advantage of relaxations from earlier in the same round. After it's done, edges from the list highlighted in blue form a critical edge ordering. Also notice, when we relax the D to B edge, it has a path equal in weight to the old path. But we don't change parents for equal distances. If we did, we'd cut off our path from the start vertex because we'd be trying to add a zero weight cycle to the shortest path we've already calculated. In the fifth round, nothing will change and we shortcut to the end of the algorithm. In the best case, the algorithm gets lucky and hits a critical edge ordering for the entire graph in one round, even if the shortest path tree has lots of levels. Then, after the second round, it shortcuts to the end. In the worst case, we only get one level at a time. For the algorithm runtime as a whole, we use the upper bound big O notation because we don't know exactly how long it will take. But we can use theta for best and worst case analysis. If that distinction still doesn't make sense, the asymptotic notation usage video in this playlist might help. With a random edge ordering, we expect to get an average of two or fewer levels from an arbitrary shortest path tree completed each round, so our expected time looks similar to our worst case time. That's it for Bellman Ford. It won't come up again until one of the last videos in the playlist where we combine a few algorithms into one. It's time for me to get my daily Botox injection. It isn't natural for a 97-year-old to look this good. Please subscribe.